She'll never know just how I feel. From out of the shadow, she walks like a dream. Make me feel crazy, make me feel so mean. Nothing gonna save you from the love that's blind. Slip to the dark side of your side.
But a goodie that our old pal the Crypt Keeper, as I bring you my top 10
Tales from the Crypt
episodes. Tales from the Crypt ran from 1989 to 1996 on HBO, and it was a powerhouse. It was a powerhouse with people behind the cameras and people in front of the cameras. Behind the cameras, we had Joel Silverman and Robert Zemeckis, who pretty much were the executive producers on the show, and they also did a lot of, Robert Zemeckis did a lot of directing with a few episodes. We also had in front of the camera some of the biggest stars of the 80s and 90s. We had everyone from Arnold Schwarzenegger to Demi Moore to some really great character actors. Corey Feldman dropped in one of these. We even had a country star, Travis Tritt, in this. I mean, pretty much everybody who was anybody seemed to be in this show. And it was taken from the old EC horror comics, Vault of Horror, and a few others, and that's where they got their story ideas. And for all you 80s and 90s babies out there, this was just a trip down memory lane. We can hack our way down memory lane together. I loved the show growing up, and I'm sure if you guys are watching this video, you guys probably did too. So without further ado, let's get to it. My top 10 Tales from the Crypt episodes. Number 10, Three's a Crowd. This episode is from season 2, and the reason why this particular episode made my list is because it is probably the most mean-spirited and darkest episode Tales from the Crypt ever did. It is lacking that dark humor that Tales from the Crypt is so famous for. This has absolutely no humor in it at all. It's probably one of the most serious episodes. Besides one other episode that I'll be talking about in my honorable mentions, this is probably one of the most serious episodes Tales from the Crypt did without a hint of humor. And this episode basically consists of paranoid delusions, alcoholism, and a really, really big misunderstanding. I think there's actually a quote that I think would sum this episode up very well, and it is by Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, and the quote goes, "For the soul is dead that slumbers, and things are not what they seem." And that quote truly does sum up this episode very well, because this is all basically about a very big misunderstanding. It's about a very unhappy man. Nothing is going well in his life. He is not where he wants to be at this point in his life. On top of all that, his wife and him want a baby very badly, and he can't even seem to get her pregnant. So he's a failure even at this very, what would be to most men, very simple, very basic thing to do. He's a failure even at that. He looks at himself as kind of just a big-time loser. The one bright spot in his life is his beautiful wife. And their anniversary is coming up, and his best friend, who is loaded and rolling in the dough, gives them this very hoity-toity cabin to go to for the weekend, and on his dime. And the reason why this episode is so dark is you just see this man descend into madness. And the more, he's very despondent and very depressed, and he just gets more so as the episode goes on. And the more depressed and despondent against, the more he goes and drinks. And his wife seems to be spending much more time with his best friend, who, remember, is very loaded, and giving her all these beautiful gifts. And instead of spending time with him, And by the end of the weekend, he basically has had a breaking point, and he thinks that he sees that there's something going on between his best friend and his wife, and he decides the only way to fix this problem is to kill them both, and that is exactly what he does. And it's the murders in this episode that are so chilling. First, he kills his best friend, and after he kills him, he hangs his body on a deer head. It's a very haunting scene to see a body strung up and hanging like that, very eerie. And then he also kills his wife, and she's very panicked, and she fights for her life with all she has, and in a minute you'll understand why she was fighting so hard. It wasn't just for herself. He proceeds to kill his wife by strangling her with a silk stocking that the best friend had bought for her. He's dragging his dead wife's corpse to the next cabin next door. He opens the door, turns on the light, and he sees... when the fog clears and everything he thought he saw, he realized was just totally misunderstood, and he realizes that he was going to be a father, and that was a secret. It wasn't an affair, it was just that he was going to be a father, that his best friend and his wife were not having an affair, and he just murdered his best wife, his wife, and his unborn child. It is a very haunting episode, and it always stuck with me, and basically nobody gets his upcomings. He basically pulls a Scott Peterson long before anybody has ever heard of who Scott Peterson was. And for some reason, this one, I saw this when I was about 7 or 8, and it's always chilled me. And he's really not a bad guy. He just doesn't think well of himself. And because of that, and alcohol, a very horrible tragedy that could have been prevented had he just been looking better. And that's why I use that quote from the beginning of the episode. I really think that sums it up very well. It's a haunting episode. It's kind of a heartbreaking episode. And that is why it is my number 10. Fitting Punishment. This episode was also from season 2, and this episode is about family, a mortuary, and disarticulation of feet, and you thought your family was dysfunctional. What this episode basically consists of is our main character, a man named Ezra, and already, you know, just by that name, he is not a pleasant fellow. He runs a mortuary, and he's a very miserly man. Unfortunately for Ezra, his life gets very complicated very quickly. When a nephew comes to live with him, he doesn't have his mother's died, he doesn't have any other family, he's basically dumped on Ezra. Ezra does not want him, but he has no choice, and all of a sudden he thinks, well, I'll get as much free help as I can from him, and all I gotta do is give him up.
You can sleep here.
Here?
That's right, boy.
Put some bedding on, it'll be fine.
Trouble ensues from him from the beginning. He thinks the kid's a dummy. He doesn't like this kid. And if this was a Disney film, this might be a sweet, you know, this could be by the beginning of the film, the two, you know, the crotchety uncle. And then toward the middle and the end of the film, he learns to love this kid. But this is not a Disney film, Boys and Ghouls. So this is Tales from the Crypt. So his heart does not get cracked wide open, and he does not learn to love his nephew. By the end of the episode, he ends up murdering his nephew. And the reason why this one, like I said, is another mean-spirited one. He does get somewhat of a revenge. I won't say how, but the nephew does sort of exact some revenge from on the grave. But it's kind of a hollow victory. He's a sweet kid, and he didn't really deserve to get murdered, unfortunately. So it's a hollow victory for him. But Ezra does get his upcomings at the end of the episode. The kid's demise comes from ordering the wrong coffin. Great episode, and that is why it's my number 9. Number 8, going from, we just had our two darkest episodes in the series, now we are going to go completely do a 180 and go to probably the most lighthearted episode of the series. This is definitely one where not just one eye is winking at the camera, but both eyes are winking at the camera, and it is The Assassins, and it is from season 6. The only notable actor in this particular episode is Corey Feldman, and for some reason this episode hardly ever gets talked about. And before I get into the actual plot of the episodes, another reason why this made my list, because this is probably the best intro that the Crypt Keeper does. Before we actually get into the episode itself, you know, if you've watched this episode, and obviously if you're watching the top 10, you've probably seen some of the episodes. Crypt Keeper always does a funny little intro before the episode. And in this one, he has death.
You might be a king or a little street sweeper, but sooner or later you dance with the Reaper.
And for all you Bill and Ted fans out there, you will know who Death is because it's the one that played in Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey. And he's playing Death, and it's just a very funny opening. They're friends, but they don't like each other, and it's just a very silly opening of them trying to one-up each other. Very funny, and so the intro alone is worth price of admission, but the episode itself is very good. And what this episode is basically about, it's about a CIA agent's cannibalism and sex change. This is a very funny episode. Like I said in the beginning, this episode does not take itself seriously at all. It's a lot of fun. It's about a little housewife who gets a surprise from three assassins, one of them being Corey Feldman, and she learns a lot more about her husband than she ever thought possible. It's also about a dinner party, and it's just hilarity ensues. One of my favorite scenes in this episode is where Corey Feldman gets killed gets strangled by a treadmill with his dick hanging out. What a great way to go out.
Come in, but stop! Is it okay? Is it okay? Stop it! Yeah, no! Help me!
And I've always loved this episode. I hate the fact that no one mentions it because I think it's probably comedically speaking, this is probably the funniest episode Tales from the Crypt ever did. And that's saying something because they did a lot of great comedic moments in this show. But this is probably the funniest episode of all of the Tales from the Crypt. And that is why it is my number 8. Number 7, Dead Right. This is from season 2. And this episode has a great cast with it. This has Denis Moore and it also has Jeffrey Tambor. Jeffrey Tambor, you guys probably know from his work in Transparent, but as a kid, I knew him then from his work on the Larry Sanders Show, where he played Hey Now, Hank Kingsley. This is a great episode, and this episode is about fortune telling, gold digging, and a 300-pound man. And what would you do for money? Basically, this episode, instead of being called Dead Right, it could be called Love or Money. This is a great episode, and Denis Moore just plays a gold digger. Too bad the song Kanye West Gold Digger wasn't around back in the day, because that song would have been perfect. She's nothing but a gold digger. And she goes to this psychic who tells her that she is going to marry a large man, and but he will die violently, and she will be left rich. And the psychic's right as far as it goes, but it has a twist ending, and I've always loved this. The chemistry between Denis Moore and Jeffrey Tambor is very good. You can kind of tell in the episode they were having a lot of fun with this. There's just some chemistry there between them. The fat suit adds another layer to it, because as you know, Jeffrey Tambor is a pretty a tall guy and a thin guy, but in this episode he's probably close to 300 pounds. And you can tell that there's just a lot of fun, and it makes you think, what would you do for love or money?
I had had a great night.
Yeah, me too. Okay.
Okay.
Denis Moore plays kind of a witch, and I think the reason why she doesn't get her a very happy ending in this is because what happens in this episode, she wants to rub it in his face.
Millionth customer with a check for $1 million.
Patty, you hit it big.
And I'm born as a dumb bitch.
Over here.
What?
It's a thrill to be rich.
You're married. What's your husband going to say about this cool million?
I can't wait to get home and tell him all about it.
Yeah.
But Jeffrey Tambor is not a sympathetic, a heavyset guy. He's kind of a jerk. He's just basically a fat jerk, for less of a better word. But it's just a really fun episode. It doesn't take itself too seriously. It's kind of a mean-spirited one, but the ending is a very satisfying one, and that is why it is my number 7. Number 6, Death of Some Salesman. This was in season 5 of Tales from the Crypt, and it is probably one of the most universally loved episodes ever. Even if you talk to someone who's just a casual fan of the show, this one 9 times out of 10 will always be mentioned in. I love this episode as well. The reason it's not higher on my list is because I'm kind of biased, because this episode has the fabulous Tim Curry, and I've had a love affair with Tim Curry since I was about 8 or 9 when I first saw the Rocky Horror Picture Show. Ever since I saw that movie, everything the man has ever been in, I automatically love. You know, he is so versatile. He can do horror, he can do comedy, he can sing, he can act. I mean, the man is just, he has more talent than anyone rightly should, and I've always loved the man, so I'm kind of biased. So I don't know, the episode itself, the storyline itself is not anything really that fantastic. What makes this fantastic is Tim Curry's acting performance. Ed Begley Jr. is also in this episode, and he does really well. And the basic premise of this episode is a sleazy salesman who cons everybody he meets out of their hard-earned cash. And then one day he goes to the wrong family, and this family is played, all three characters are played, there's a Ma, a Pa, and a Winona. No, not Winona Judd, just Winona. And Tim Curry plays all three characters, and he's them flawlessly. I mean, you know, you don't even know the makeup effects are so good, and he puts a spin on each character so well that you'd think it was three different actors playing all these characters instead of just one. And that's a real talent and a real credit to his acting ability. But that is why this, but it's fun. The end of the episode, definitely, like a lot of Tales from the Crypt episodes, he gets his upcomings, and pretty much we start out the episode with...
It's called salesmanship.
And at the end of the episode...
Salesmanship!
So if you haven't seen it, I would highly recommend it, and that is why it is my number 6. Number 5, Werewolf Concerto. This is from season 4. And this one is basically, the episode is called Werewolf Concerto, but you could probably also call this 007 Meets the Wolfman. And the reason I say that is because Timothy Dalton is in this episode. And for those of you who might be too young to remember, Timothy Dalton did do a couple of stints as James Bond. I think...
Who are you?
Bond, James Bond.
I think he only did like 2 or 3 movies. And I know a lot of Bond people. I have a couple friends that are major Bond fans. He's usually not a very popular one with a lot of James Bonds, but I actually like him. He's probably my favorite, most underrated James Bond of all of them. That's sacrilegious to say, I know, among some Bond people, but I've always liked him for that reason. Also in this episode, we have Beverly D'Angelo, as well as Wolfgang Puck does a really fun little cameo as the hotel chef. And basically what this episode is about, it's nothing new to Tales from the Crypt. It's definitely an episode that doesn't take itself very seriously, and it's more fun than scary. It has werewolves, and it also has a twist at the ending involving a vampire. The special effects of this episode are very well done. It's just basically a nod to the old... to the old Universal monsters, Wolfman and Dracula. And basically that's what it is. It's kind of a Wolfman meets Dracula in a modern day Tales from the Crypt kind of way. And this episode is always just another one that's just always stuck out in my mind. It's not one that gets talked about too much, but it's a lot of fun, and I like the fact that it just does not take itself at all seriously. Werewolves and vampires are nothing new with Tales from the Crypt, but I think this was the best werewolf episode Tales from the Crypt ever did. So that is why it is my number 5. Number 4, Abracadaver. This is another one that I feel doesn't get enough love. It doesn't get talked about or mentioned a lot, and I think it's kind of a shame because this is a really great episode. This episode has a lot in common with the Stephen King short story, Autopsy Room 4, from his book Everything's Eventual. I see a lot of similarities between this episode and that book. For all you bookworms out there, if you haven't read that one, I would definitely recommend it. It's a great read. But the episode basically is about pranks, heart attacks, brothers, and death. This episode was from season 4, and it doesn't have any notable actors in it except for Beau Bridges. Everyone else is pretty much unknown. And like I said, this episode doesn't take itself very seriously. But if you really sit down and think of the premise of this episode, and what it basically is about is it kind of makes you think of what could possibly happen after we die, what comes next. And, you know, most people believe one of two things. they either believe that it's just we completely black out and there's just literally nothing after we die, it's just like turning off a light, or you are in the camp that you believe that we go on. Now, how do we go on? There's a million different theories on that, but there's something beyond after our death. But this premise is a very interesting premise because it basically says that, yes, our body's dead, but we are still there. We can still see, hear, and feel. And that's kind of a very scary idea if you really give it some thought.
Touch is the first sense to go. I hope it's true because that organ donor truck is going to be by real soon, and I don't think that's going to feel real good.
It kind of makes you think that, oh boy, if that's a possibility, I might want to live forever. And that's basically what this episode explores. It explores the possibility that even after our brain and hearts have stopped, somehow our senses are still alive and we still are aware of what's going on. And give that some thought. Let that really sink in. And that's a terrifying thought. It's done in a very tongue-in-cheek way, but like I said, it's a very terrifying thought if you really sit down and think about it. And that thought has always stuck with me, and that is why this is my number four episode. Great watch. If you haven't watched it, check it out. Number three, The Trap. This episode, probably the reason why most people will remember it is because of who directed it. And the person who directed this was Michael J. Fox. Michael J. Fox also has a blink, if you blink, you'll miss it, cameo.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury.
The episode also has some other great actors in it as well. It has the late, great Bruno Kirby as well as Terry Garr. And what this episode is about is insurance fraud, an illicit love affair, and again, it has the brother angle. This series really seems to really push the brother angles, because I've seen them. I've watched this whole series recently, and the brother angle is one thing that seems to be a consistent theme in this Tales from the Crypt. It's always about brothers, and this episode is no different. Basically, what this is about two brothers. The older brother is kind of a bum and a failure, can't ever hold a job. Him and his wife, played by Terry Garr, are always on the verge of bankruptcy. His younger brother is the town medical examiner, and as him and his wife one day are trying to figure out how they're going to pay the bills, he mentions, I think I'm worth more dead than alive. And a light bulb literally goes over his head, and he gets the idea to fake his own death, have his little brother help him, and remember, his little brother is a medical examiner, so that will come in very handy. And the three of them will fake his own death, get the insurance money, and go live in the tropics somewhere, and everyone's going to be a happy ending. Of course, this is Tales from the Crypt, so that's not the way this episode plays out. The reason why I love this episode is because amongst all this other stuff that's going on, Bruno Kirby, who again is his little brother, has strong feelings for his older brother's wife. And in the scene where they're about to cremate the body, he's in the coffin. They're not really going to cremate the body, they're just doing this for show for the insurance money. And the reason why I love this one is because this is a scene where they finally give in to their passion.
Billy.
Why this is my number three episode. I've always loved that scene. And again, everyone who does get the who deserves it gets their upcubbins. Bruno Kirby and Terry Garr get a happily ever after. It's a very fun episode, and I think Michael J. Fox did a great job directing it. And that is why it is my number three. Ooh, The Third Pig. As I said at the beginning of this video, this is the only episode from season 7. Like I said, this is where we jumped across the pond to England, and this was the last episode of Tales from the Crypt. This was kind of the series finale, and although that whole season 7 is probably their weakest of the whole series of this Tales from the Crypt, they did go out on a strong note because this is a very great episode. Not only is this the final episode, this was also, they brought back American actors for this last episode, and this is the only Tales from the Crypt episode to be animated. And the cast of characters the voice talents, I guess I should say, in this episode are Bobcat Goldthwait and Brad Garrett. And you guys might not know the name Brad Garrett, but if you are a fan of Everybody Loves Raymond, he played the brother on Everybody Loves Raymond. And he's a pretty well-renowned voice actor in his own right. If you're into the voice acting and cartoons and stuff, he has a very distinctive deep voice, so you probably know who he is if you don't watch Everybody Loves Raymond. But anyway, like I said, and it's basically just a retelling of The Three Little Pigs meets Frankenstein is the best way to tell it. This is an awesome, it's a fractured fairy tale that only Tales from the Crypt could bring you, and it's a lot of fun. I wish someone had read this fairy tale to me instead of The Three Little Pigs, because this is a way awesomer Three Little Pigs retelling. Bobcat Goldthwait does the voice of the wolf. Crypt Keeper is the narrator, and Brad Garrett plays one of the misfortune pigs. And like I said, this one, no one really gets a happy ending. Everybody's kind of horrible in this.
I love this ending. I think it's neat. And I've only one thing to say. Pork the other light meat.
It's always been one of my favorites, and that is why it's my number two. Okay, boys and ghouls, before I unveil my top number one pick for Tales from the Crypt episode that reigns supreme above all others, I do have some honorable mentions, and this was very, very hard to leave out some of these episodes. I wish I had more time. I would probably do a top 20, but for the sake of time, I will just mention really quickly some great episodes that, for whatever reason, didn't make my list. And the first episode I'm going to talk about didn't make my list because I wanted these episodes to be episodes I enjoyed when I was a kid, and also episodes I enjoy now. And this particular episode, I did not enjoy as a kid. It really impacted me as an adult, but this was always one that I would, if it was playing in reruns, I would always skip when I was younger. It wasn't until I got older that I really saw how great this episode was. And of course, I am talking about Yellow. And Yellow is a great episode for many reasons. Number one, it has it's about a father and son, and the neat thing about this is the actors playing father and son are actually father and son in real life.
What are the men are saying about you?
It depends, sir. What are the men saying?
They're saying, Lieutenant, that you're Yellow.
And that was Kurt and Eric Douglas. Along with Kurt and Eric Douglas, this episode also has Dan Aykroyd and Lance Hendrickson. And this is probably the most serious toned of all the Tales from the Crypt episodes. This is probably the one that is the most serious of all of the episodes. And it's a war story, and I'm not big on war, at least when I was a kid, that they never really interested me much. But this one really, as I've gotten older, this one really, really works really well. Like I said, it's a very serious one, and it's the only episode of Tales from the Crypt to go over 30 minutes. I think this was about an hour-long episode. Great episode. If you haven't seen it, I would highly recommend it. Another episode that I did make my list would be Top Billing. This was another great episode with the great John Lovitz, and that's why it didn't make my list, because the story itself is pretty Tales from the Crypty, for lack of a better term. But it has a great cast. Not only does it have John Lovitz, it has John Ashton. And if you younger kids don't know who John Ashton is, he was Gomez on The Addams Family, and he's done a lot of other things as well. But probably most people will most notably know him from either Gomez on The Addams Family or Buddy from Night Court. I'm feeling much better now. And Top Billing, this one is about a theater company, and the twist is it's run by lunatics. And John Lovitz doesn't realize this, and he gets the part of his life. He just has to pay with his life.
York's been dead 23 years before the play starts.
We've had a hell of a time casting the part.
Someone keeps stealing the skull.
That's crazy.
To get the part. It's a great one, it's a very funny one, and I like it a lot. Another one that I want to mention that doesn't get mentioned enough, and this is just a personal one for me, it's an episode called For Crying Out Loud. And this isn't that great of an episode. Again, it's the people in the episode that really make it work, and it's a very biased one for me because it has my all-time favorite comedian in this episode. It's Sam Kinison playing basically Jimmy, Tales from the Crypt version of Jiminy Cricket. He plays...
Marty, morality aside, this is a felony. We're talking about 45 years in prison.
That is an aberration, just like the doctor said it was.
I know you have ambitions, Marty, but I don't think they include being gang raped by the entire Aryan Nation's weightlifting club.
Somebody's conscience. We never see him in the actual episode, but you hear his voice, and he plays a conscience. It also has Iggy Pop.
I'm only 5'1". I got a pain in my neck.
And it's about a rock promoter who is embezzling money, and he has to kill, and someone catches on to him, a bank teller, actually, catches on to what he's doing and threatens to turn him in if he doesn't give him half the money. He doesn't want to give up his money, so he murders her, and that's when his conscience kicks in, and the whole episode is he going to turn himself in and do the right thing, or is he going to try to flee and get away with it? And it's a really great episode, and like I said, it's really not notable for anything except for the fact that it has Iggy Pop and Sam Kinison, and I love both of those guys, so I had to give a shout out for that one. Another one that I would like to make my honorable mentions is one called Doctor of Horror, and the episode is pretty wacky. It's about a mad doctor trying to steal souls from the recently dead, and there's two security guards. This episode had Ben Stein and Travis Tritt, and that is really what I remember mostly from this episode is Travis Tritt. And if you guys don't know who Travis Tritt is...
From 9 till a half past 1.
He was a country singer in the 80s and 90s. I think he's still putting out albums, but his big heyday was in the late 80s and 90s. And he did a little bit of acting, but I always wondered what he was doing in a Tales from the Crypt episode.
Not much. I'm just going to play God.
He was, I don't know if he was a big horror fan or if he had a friend on the show. I don't know, but I always wondered if anyone knows why he agreed to do that particular Tales from the Crypt episode. I'd love to hear about it in the comments, because that is pretty much why I remember that episode, is because Travis Tritt, and he looks like he is having a very good time, but it's very strange to have a country superstar on a Tales from the Crypt episode. Okay, and another honorable mention I would like to talk about is You Murderer. This episode is infamous too, and it's probably one that you see on everybody's list. And the reason this one is so special is for a lot of reasons. We have the three main ones is Alfred Hitchcock, Humphrey Bogart, and special effects. This episode had John Lithgow, Isabella Rossellini, and Humphrey Bogart that they used through special effects. And at the time period, this was like a state-of-the-art special effects. I don't know if it had never been done, but if it had been done, it had been very rarely done, and maybe not for a television show. It's a cute idea. They're basically using Humphrey Bogart telling the story. It's a cute nod to Casablanca.
What would you say if I told you I'll never leave you?
Nobody ever loved me that much.
They're having Isabella Rossellini in it as well. Robert Zemeckis directed this episode, and it's a cute episode. The reason why it's in my honorable mentions is because although the special effects are great and it's a cute story, it was never a favorite of mine, but I felt like I had to bring it in my honorable mentions because everybody seems to love this episode, so I figured I had to give some love to it. It's not a bad episode, but it definitely wouldn't. That's why it made it into my honorable mentions instead of my top 10 list. But check it out. It's a cute one. If you're a classic film buff, you might really like this episode. Check it out. And the last honorable mention before I get to my number one would be Television of Terror. And this one is most notable. Again, it doesn't have it doesn't have anyone really notable in the cast, but it is notable because it basically was reality TV about 10, 12 years before anyone knew what reality TV was. It is about a talk show host who goes on live to a reportedly haunted house.
Tonight, we'll find out, because I'm going inside the Ritter House. Ah, but you'll be with me on this special haunting edition of Horton Rivers Live.
It's a very dark episode, and murder ensues. And like I said, it's broadcast live. And back in the early 90s, no one knew what reality television was. It could literally be credited as the first reality TV television episode. That is why it is. That is why I had to give an honorable mention. And that is it for my honorable mentions. Okay, and my number one top Tales from the Crypt episode is What's Cooking? Hey, good looking. What you got cooking? And the answer to that question is cannibalism. Yay, cannibalism! I am all about the cannibalism. I love any kind of movie about cannibalism, and this is my favorite Tales from the Crypt episode about cannibalism. And I'm a vegetarian, so I guess that just makes me very ironic. Okay, enough of the pretentious corner. What's Cooking is my favorite episode for many reasons. One, it has a phenomenal cast. It has Christopher Reeves. Yes, Superman was in a Tales from the Crypt episode. We also have Judd Nelson. Don't you forget about him. The Breakfast Club for all you non-80s babies out there. And also, he will do anything, but he won't do cannibalism. Meatloaf is also in this episode. And that's probably another reason why this made it to my all-time favorite, is because I love Meatloaf. I'm as much of a music junkie as I am a horror nerd. So, yeah, anytime we have any singer it'll always work for me. But aside from the phenomenal cast, the story is just plain fun. It's about squid, it's about cannibalism, and it's about revenge. And the right people get their upcomings in the end, like a lot of Tales from the Crypt does. Christopher Reeves, I read a biography about him, and he said that he had a lot of fun when he made this episode. Speaking of his acting career, this was probably one of the most fun projects he ever did. And Judd Nelson is very good. He plays a real jerk and a creep, and he murders somebody, and you think it's maybe out of the kindness of his heart, but he actually has all other ulterior motives. And the best part of this episode is Meatloaf not only gets killed, but he also gets chopped up.
Mr. Chumley.
Now where have I seen that? I know there's another instance of where have I seen that? Oh well. Gets murdered and cannibalized a lot in his movie career, and I think that's awesome. What better way to have a movie career than to be murdered and cannibalized? This is a great episode. This is a fun episode. And like I said, basically the restaurant goes from being a squid establishment.
Honey, if you bury that thing in the back of my neck, you're just gonna wreck the blade. It's a real expensive cleaver. They don't make them anymore.
To steaks, only the steaks aren't made of cow, they're made of people, and everybody loves them. Everybody has a craving for this, and like I said, Judd Nelson gets his upcomings, poor Meatloaf gets cannibalized, and Christopher Reeve, Superman, gets and his wife live happily ever after. What more can you ask for? A great episode, fun episode, and my all-time favorite Tales from the Crypt episodes. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is my top 10 Tales from the Crypt episode. I hope you enjoyed watching this. Please, if you like this video, please hit that subscribe button. And if you have anything that you'd like to tell me or share with me, please leave me a comment. I really love getting comments from all you guys. I'll bid you all a wonderful night. I hope you all have a great night or a great morning or whenever you're watching this video. And bye!